Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Solitude and Company by Silvana Paternostro. Translated by Edith Grossman. Read by Robert Fass. I am consoled, however, that at times oral history might be better than written, and without knowing it, we may be inventing a new genre needed by literature, fiction about fiction. Gabriel García Márquez, Living to Tell the Tale. Prologue. In November 2000, the magazine Talk, recently founded by Tina Brown, asked me to prepare an oral history of Gabriel García Márquez. They wanted 2,000 words, badly counted and with photographs that amounted to 3 or 4 pages. That is, something short. Definitely not his biography. I was hired because, although I've lived in New York since 1986, I was born in Barranquilla, and therefore was a neighbor of the imaginary world of Macondo. Besides, in the winter 1996 issue of the Paris Review, I had published 3 Days with Gabo, a detailed chronicle of a journalism workshop García Márquez offered in Cartagena, and which I attended as a student. I proposed that instead of interviewing the heads of state, movie stars, and immensely wealthy men with whom he associated on a daily basis, I would travel to Colombia to talk with those who knew him before he became the legendary Latin American author. When I said I would even talk to the characters who appear in 100 Years of Solitude, referring to a group of friends he had immortalized as the Pranksters of La Cueva, and the first and last friends that he ever had in his life, they immediately sent me a plane ticket that I found very funny, because printed on the front of the folder that held the ticket was the image of Mickey Mouse. Talk was financed by the Disney Corporation. After Colombia, I have to go to Mexico, I risked telling the editor. That was where he wrote the novel. Whatever you need, was the answer. The piece was never published. Talk closed because the formula of mixing show business with journalism and literature was not an obvious success. What other magazine puts a bare-chested Hugh Grant on the cover and devotes 6 pages to a serious section on books? The editor who had asked me for it told me not long ago. Only Tina would have asked for an oral history of Gabriel García Márquez. Thanks to Tina's daring, however, I was able to produce 24 tapes, 90 minutes on each side, of people talking about Gabriel García Márquez. I published a few pieces carved out of those conversations. In 2002, when Living to Tell the Tale, his book of memories, was published in Spanish, the magazine El Malpensante, The Evil Minded, came out with a more Colombian and more extensive version of what I had prepared for Talk. I called it Solitude and Company, the name that at one point García Márquez was going to give to a film production company he wanted to set up with some Colombian partners. With the same title, I published another version in the edition of the Paris Review commemorating its 50th anniversary, which in turn was translated and published in Mexico by the magazine Nexos in its spring 2003 issue. Almost a decade went by before I decided in March 2010 that it was time to listen to those tapes again and transform them into this book. When I finished listening to them, though, I realized that what I had was not enough for a book. I needed to fill in gaps, which is why I began a second round of interviews with those who I thought would provide context and chronology to the first voices. Solitude and Company is divided into 2 parts. In the first, B.C., before Cien Años de Soledad, his siblings speak, as well as those who were his buddies before he became the universally loved Latin American icon, those who knew him when he still didn't have a proper English tailor nor an English biographer, 2 things I heard him say are the marks of a writer's success, and didn't accompany presidents and multimillionaires, as on the night I saw him cut the baby blue inaugural ribbon at the Museo Soumaya, Carlos Slim's gift to Mexico City, which reminded me of the interviews I had prepared for Talk. This first part gathers together the voices of those irreverent and hopeful times when a boy from the provinces decided to become a writer. This is the story of how he did it. Here we witness the formation of the creator venerated throughout the world. In the second part, A.C., after Cien Años de Soledad, a prize-winning García Márquez appears, a celebrated man. A great deal has been written about García Márquez, but no matter how much is written, the author's prose, the censorship of his memories, and the analysis of his biographer weigh heavily. Oral history, the formal name of this genre, allows those who were very close to him to describe for us the man who became the most important writer in Latin America, the lover of power, and defender to the end of Fidel Castro. It allows them to tell us how they welcomed him, helped him, and watched him create himself. It permits them to make us feel how much they love him, or how much he annoyed them. Just them, without other narrators or descriptions as intermediaries. This book, then, is a ticket to a celebration where everybody talks, everybody shouts, everybody has an opinion, and even tells lies. That is the essence of oral history. Along the lines of Edie, American Girl by Jean Stein and George Plimpton, and Truman Capote, in which various friends, enemies, acquaintances, and detractors recall his turbulent career by Plimpton. This format, which fell from the skies with that imperative phone call from Tina Brown, is formidable because it is amusing and light, yet profoundly true. But you must keep in mind that each morsel of dialogue deals with the version of the person who is speaking. Listening to it is as fun as attending a fiesta and stopping to listen to the guests talk about García Márquez. And as at the best parties, some speak more than others. The shouters are here, the super analytical, the pranksters, the singers, the vulgar, and even those who have had too much to drink. At this party, we are with the company that made possible the solitude that García Márquez needed to write his 100 years of solitude. To write this book, I didn't speak to García Márquez. That is exactly what oral history demands. That is, it is written with the voices of others. Oral history involves talking to someone about a person without that person being present. And even more important, recording those conversations. To begin working, I organized the tapes in the order in which the interviews had been held. Then I started to listen to the interviews I had conducted and recorded more than a decade before. Through the headphones, I heard my own laughter, but at the same time, new questions jumped out at me. For example, I chuckled listening to the people from my native Barranquilla. But I also realized that outside of Colombia, no one understands what nursing at a rooster's tit means. Then I understood that I had to resolve not only how to explain Barranquillan argot, but also the fact that I was talking to people of advanced age. Their memory would fail, and they would stammer when they couldn't remember something. And since I wasn't going to give them back their memories, I left in their voices the tenderness of their declining years. Music, especially the vallenato, an accordion-infused country blues, played an important part in those first conversations, and more than once the interviewees broke into song, and so I let them sing here too. I also include the machista logic of the judge García Márquez consulted so that he could tell him what had happened on that fateful Sunday when, as a young man, the magistrate had witnessed what the world knows today as the chronicle of a death foretold. I also include a lot of explanations about Barranquilla, because it is not only fertile ground for the so-called magical realism, it is also where García Márquez met his first and last friends, the wise Catalonian, along with Alfonso, Álvaro, Germán, and a few others of the arguers who appear in the last chapter of 100 Years of Solitude. When I arrived in Barranquilla with my tape recorder, these faithful friends had all passed away, but I was lucky to find two survivors to tell me what they were like when they took care of García Márquez. This book is an homage to friendship, a recognition of his friends because in Barranquilla he certainly had the very best. Looking for more accounts of friendship, I wanted to communicate with Maria Luisa Elio and Jumi Garcia Ascot. 100 Years of Solitude is dedicated to them. All the gabologists and gabolators in Colombia knew by heart the works and miracles of the arguers that appear in the novel, but no one could tell me anything about these two people, obviously important in the life of the author, other than that they lived in Mexico City. I arrived in Mexico City with another ticket from Disney, registered at the Casa Durango, and began my search. Carlos Monsiváis told me they were a Spanish couple, told me that Jumi, the husband, had died, and gave me the phone number of the señora. The next day, a very attractive and elegant lady in a gray-blue pantsuit that matched the color of her eyes and scarf received me in the library of a house to the south of the city. She was as generous with her stories as she had been with Gabriel García Márquez, when for hours she listened to him, simply the friend of a friend at a dinner party, recount the story of the book he was planning to write. That idea turned into 100 Years of Solitude, and the first edition is dedicated to her. I am sure she recounted the story of that dinner party at many other dinner parties. That afternoon, Maria Luisa Elio told me as I turned on my tape recorder that this was the first formal taped interview of that memory. There are certain individuals who are not as close to García Márquez, and a few who never met him. However, their commentary on moments in Colombia's history that marked the life of the writer, like the assassination of Jorge Eliezer Gaitán on April 9, 1948, and the historical period known as the violence unleashed by this event, are essential to understanding the history of García Márquez and of his books. Nereo López, the official photographer of the Colombian delegation sent to Stockholm when García Márquez received the Nobel Prize, moved to New York in 1997 when he was 80 to open up his horizons, and I took advantage of his admirable audacity to have him talk to me about the days when García Márquez was just another colleague and Colombia was bleeding to death. His vivid recollections brought history to life. Here, a García Márquez appears without the self-censorship of living to tell the tale, and without the weight of the more than 700 pages of the excellent biographies by Dasso Saldívar and Gerald Martin. It is a rich, rare historical document that retrieves the collective memory of his life and reflects on the work of being a writer, of how he comes to the necessary Rilkean pact with solitude. It is a book that demonstrates how friendship and circumstances, but above all, discipline and dedication, are necessary in order to triumph. His close friend, the Argentinian writer Tomás Eloy Martínez, confessed to me that in order to be Gabo's friend, you had to take an omerta, as if you were in the mafia. You have to never write about him, he told me one afternoon on his patio in New Jersey. García Márquez recounts that in Paris, when he was young and poor, he had seen Ernest Hemingway in a park. Instead of approaching him and beginning a conversation, he decided to shout his name from the other side of the little square, raise his hand, and signal with that gesture how much he respected him. I understood the fear he felt, for it is very difficult to let oneself be tempted by proximity. I have written this book from a distance and in the same spirit. It is a human portrait of someone who turned into a legend. I firmly believe we are bigger, more important, more eternal, and even more saintly than myths. García Márquez is great without our having to accept the comfortable tales that he had no errors, defects, defeats, recklessness, loves, or enmities. If we do that, we will only contribute to an empty foolishness. To enjoy this book, one must put aside the notion that everything in life has a single truth. Oral history contrasts each person's truth. That is part of its charm. Come to this party with that in mind, and holding a whiskey on the rocks, or a glass of champagne, which is what I am told Gabo himself preferred. If you are in for the full experience, Walk to your bookshelf and take out your copy of 100 Years of Solitude, or go to your nearest bookstore and buy it. Go through it again, or for the first time, now that you've heard the fun facts and indiscretions, the behind the scenes of what is described as probably the finest and most famous work, a classic of world literature for all time. The last two chapters will fill you with delight as you understand the winks he made to his friends. I hope you will laugh out loud when you hear, for example, that Alvaro frightened the crocodiles with his noisy laughter, and Alfonso invented outlandish stories about the bitterns who had pecked out the eyes of four customers who misbehaved the week before, and Gabriel was in the room of the pensive mulatto girl who did not collect in money, but in letters to a smuggler boyfriend who was in prison on the other side of the Orinoco, because the border guards had caught him and had made him sit on a chamber pot that filled up with a mixture of shit and diamonds. You will understand why he always contested those who said he had a great imagination with a simple sentence: everything in his fiction is based on facts. 100 Years of Solitude. The Earthquake of 1967. Gregory Rabassa. It happened the way earthquakes happen. We can't predict earthquakes, even though we know they're going to happen. Emmanuel Carballo. An astonishing case in the history of literature in Spanish. It's something genetic. There are genes that predestine you to be a great writer, and he worked very hard. He didn't devote himself to literature gratuitously, but he worked very hard, very, very disciplined. He left all his jobs, borrowed money, sold things, and shut himself up in his house for 8 months to write. His entire family, his wife, his sons, his friends, we all made an empty space around him because he was frenetically dedicated to one thing. They lived very modestly in a small apartment. There were no luxuries there. They spent only what was necessary. Everyone agreed that he should have peace, time, and affection. And thanks to that, principally to his family and his friends, the novel was written. I was the person who read the novel from the time he began to write it until he finished it. And because I was reading and commenting chapter after chapter every week, by the time he brought over the next chapter, I had nothing to correct, nothing to replace, because all my suggestions were already there in the novel. Maria Luisa Elio. He gave me pieces to read. What Gabo had written at night, he would read us parts the next day. And from that first moment, you realized it was a marvel. He knew it. Guillermo Angulo. No, he didn't know. In fact, he was very doubtful that it would be a good novel. When it was published, he sent me a copy. I read it. I liked it a great deal. He sent me another copy. I don't have my copy, because I had to pass it on to Herman Vargas, and Herman Vargas had to pass it on to Plinio. And I ought to tell you something that I don't believe anyone has told you and that no one is going to tell you. Plinio reprimanded him because it was anti-communist. What? The country's full of problems and you're writing a fairy tale? Maria Luisa Elio. One isn't a fool, and I can be very cutting where literature is concerned. I mean, whomever it is can be a very famous writer, and if I don't like it, I don't like it. So I read it, and I knew that this Señor García Márquez was very great. I didn't doubt it for a second. I thought the book was really good, but I'll be frank with you, to that degree, no. Santiago Mutis. They lost control of the situation, abroad and in Colombia too, because Gabo became an event, a phenomenon. Everyone kneeled down before him. I don't know whether Gabo tells this or Tomás Eloy Martínez. 1 week after they published the novel there, Gabo travels to Buenos Aires, not because of 100 Years of Solitude, but to be a judge at a fiction competition. One night, they go to the theater, and when Gabo goes in, someone recognizes him. The entire audience gets up and applauds him. That's where it began. And it hasn't stopped. It didn't stop, ever. That is, they never left him alone. Rodrigo Moya. On November 29, 1966, Gabriel García Márquez visits me in my home in the Condesa building, accompanied by his wife Mercedes, so that one of my photographs would illustrate the first edition. I took the photographs in my house, which had a good deal of natural light. He arrived wearing a plaid jacket. He loved those plaids. He looked impassive, but he certainly was conscious of the camera. He was conscious that he had created a masterpiece. He had already written a great deal, he had already had success, and throughout the work you can breathe the certainty that only geniuses have. I had that impression then. Of course, not the magnitude. Gabo was just 39 years old, but a foretelling of what was to come. B.C. Before Cien Años de Soledad. 1. The son of Luisa Santiaga and Gabriel Eligio. How the son of the telegraph operator in Aracataca begins to collect stories in the cradle. Rafael Ulloa. Gabo wasn't born in 1928, but in 1927. He says he was born in 28 to coincide with the slaughter on the banana plantations, but it was his brother who was born in 28. Luis Enrique García Márquez. Until 1955, I thought I had come into this world on September 8, 1928, after my mother's 9 months of pregnancy. But it happened that in that year of 1955, Gabito wrote the story of a shipwrecked sailor in El Espectador, and he had difficulties with the government of General Rojas Pinilla. Then he had to leave the country, for which he needed a certain document, and in that document, I don't know why, it was stated that Gabito was born on March 6, 1928. That is the same year I was born, something which left me in a difficult situation, either being the only six-month premature baby on record who weighed 10 pounds, 2 ounces, or almost his twin. He never corrected the date, but the one who was born in 1928 in Aracataca, Magdalena, was me. Gabito was born on March 6th of 27. Ramon Iyan Baca. Luisa, Gabo's mother, was a well-regarded person. They were what we would call well-regarded people. What were well-regarded people back then? They were people valued by the people of the provincial upper class, because we're talking about the upper-class people of Santa Marta. As the Bogotanos would say, "You're decent people from the hot land." Luisa studied at the Colegio de la Presentación in Santa Marta, which was the secondary school for the high class, but they were just well-regarded. That is, they were people invited to some parties and not to others. It all depends on what party it was. Señor García, his father, I don't think he was even well-regarded. Rafael Ulloa. Gabriel Eligio García is the father. My mother is first cousin to García Márquez's father, so my mother told me a little about family issues. And I'm a great fan of García Márquez. I've read all his books. I'm from Sincay, of course. It's the hometown of this gentleman's father. Sincay, spelled with a C. The town was called San Luis de Sincay, but for people it was Sincay. Carmelo Martinez. Luisa Santiaga, Gabito's mother, was a white lady, short, with a wart right here, white, the same age as my mother. My mother was born in 1904 and Luisa in the same year. She's about 96 years old. She doesn't know anything anymore. Rafael Ulloa. Carlos H. Pareja is from Sincay and is related to Gabito's father. And, well, Carlos had good connections. He helped Gabo's father so he could begin to study medicine, but he ran out of dough, and then, since he was in a bad situation, they told him, "Don't fuck around, do something, find a job." And then he was appointed telegraph operator in Aracataca. When he went there, he fell in love with Luisa Santiago Márquez, who was the daughter of Colonel Márquez. His mother was a very peaceful woman, Luisa Santiago Márquez. She was a good friend of my mother's. Jaime García Márquez. They say that Gabriel Eligio García, my father, came to Aracataca as a telegraph operator
and saw Luisa, my mother, one day and liked the girl right away. One day, he approached her and said, "After carefully analyzing the women I've met in Aracataca, I have reached the conclusion that the one who suits me best," that's how he said it, "suits me, is you. I want to marry you. Think it over. But if you decide not to, tell me and don't worry because I'm not dying for you." I think what happened was that he was dying of fear that she would turn him down, and to protect himself, he made that ridiculous declaration. And I think so because we're all the same, very affectionate with our women. Ramon Iyanbaca. Not even the colonel, Luisa's father, wanted Gabriel Eligio. He was on a lower level, and the people cared a great deal about these levels back then, because they were small places and everyone lived closer together. Luis Enrique Garcia Marquez. From the beginning, the marriage was nomadic. They married in Santa Marta, went to Riohacha for their honeymoon, and settled there. They returned to Aracataca when Gabito was about to be born, and then, when I was about 4 months old, we went to Barranquilla. All that moving around in just 2.5 years, between June 1926, when they married, and January 1929, when we went to Barranquilla. As you know, Gabito stayed in Aracataca with our grandparents. Carmelo Martinez. He was raised by his maternal grandparents, who didn't call him Gabrielito, but Gabito, and so he was called Gabito. I call him Gabito, not Gabo. Rafael Ulloa. Besides, Colonel Marquez was a liberal and had fought in the War of 1,000 Days. And this guy, Gabriel Eligio, who was from Sinsay, was a goth, a conservative. "Don't fuck with me. I don't want anything to do with that son of a bitch goth here. Send the girl to another town." Then, since Gabriel Eligio was a telegraph operator, he began to send Luisa messages along the telegraph wires. And in the end, they married because they couldn't hide. Patricia Castaño. In 1926, when this Señor Garcia arrives in Aracataca as a telegraph operator and they, Luisa Santiago's family, begin to oppose him, they decide to take this trip so that this gentleman will forget about her and they can introduce her to her family that had remained in Barrancas and to her new friends. They leave Aracataca and go down toward Valledupar, they go around the Sierra, and they pass through Valledupar and through Patillal until they come to Barrancas. It's the first time that Tranquilina, Gabo's grandmother, goes back there. It was very far. It looked as if it were on the corner, but it was very far, and they spent 2 or 3 months getting there. There wasn't even a highway. We're talking about 1926 or 27. They traveled by mule along horse paths at the edge of the Sierra, and they stayed there. They kept in touch through the telegraph operators. There I heard that she kept the telegrams under the fireboxes in the stove. Who would have thought of looking for them there? Imagine that beneath every firebox there was something like a metal plate, and she placed the letters beneath that firebox. She knew that messages went from telegraph office to telegraph office. Back then, they were called Marconi. She knew that in the telegraph office was his message that arrived on yellow paper. We went to Barrancas with Gerald Martin, the English biographer, and several of Garcia Marquez's siblings. They took us to the places where there are pools in the river, where they had outings, and there are references in her letters to their going on an excursion to the river. Then, yes, that trip was marvelous. And the most impressive thing is that fireboxes still exist. There are fireboxes in a back corner of some houses. You still find people who cook on these fireboxes or keep the firebox on the floor. Aida Garcia Marquez. Gabito's arrival united the family, because when my father came from Riohacha to Aracataca, Gabito had been born, and thanks to that, they gave him a warm welcome. And so everything was arranged. And since my grandparents were the godparents at the baptism, they also became compadres. My grandfather Nicolás began to call my father my compadre Gabriel Eligio. And then it happened that the grandson was staying to live in my grandparents' house. Then Luis Enrique was born, and my parents went to live in Barranquilla, where Margot was born, who was always sick because she ate dirt, like Rebecca in 100 Years of Solitude. My granny went to Barranquilla to visit, and she thought Margot was undernourished, so then she told my mother to let her take her, that she would give her iron and take care of her, and so Margot began living with my grandparents too. In Barranquilla, my father had a successful pharmacy. My mother went back and forth between Aracataca and Barranquilla to visit my grandparents and to see Gabito and Margot. Carmelo Martinez. Gabriel García Martinez was dark, Indian dark, not black dark, a very imaginative man. Gabito's imagination was due to his father's imagination. He was a very interesting man, imaginative.
Rafael Ulloa.
His father was also half a doctor. In the family, there were always not only pharmacists, but herbalists and some witches. There was a man in our family, on the Paternina side, that they say prepared certain pomades, and then, what a powerful pomade! It works against every poison! He would spread the pomade on his hand and let a snake bite him. Of course, the snake had no poison, but he performed his pantomime in the crowded square. He lived around Sinsay. Gabito uses that guy in his stories.
Carmelo Martinez.
Besides, his father was a conservative like me.
Rafael Ulloa.
Very few people know that his father almost wasn't really Garcia, but Martinez. They should be Martinez, not Garcia. He should be Gabriel Martinez Marquez, not Gabriel Garcia Marquez. You know that in the past, in the small towns, there was a problem. Many people were born out of wedlock, and Gabo's father was born out of wedlock, and so he took his mother's name, Garcia. Argemira Garcia was the daughter of a Señor Garcia who had arrived in Sinsay with Losana Paternina. This Losana Paternina was the sister of my grandfather, my mother's father, and so I knew Gabito. When they gave him the Nobel Prize, the story came out, but they killed it because, don't fuck around, he's a huge writer. How do you say he's an illegitimate child now out there?
Jaime Garcia Marquez.
Besides being a telegraph operator, an occupation that was so ephemeral that sometimes it seems to me it wasn't even real and that it's an invention of Gabito's, my father was a versatile man who recited verses and played the violin.
Margarita de la Vega.
When I met his father, he was one of those men who sat, they do it much less now in Cartagena, what with all the tourism, in the Plaza de Bolívar, that is, the square that's outside the Palace of the Inquisition and the City Hall. The one where they have a folklore dancer now every afternoon. The locals would sit there and talk, especially at dusk and things like that. My father never sat there because he didn't have the time. He would converse at other times, because he was a doctor and his office was nearby. And an uncle, for example, who was the wastrel of the family and didn't do anything, passed his time sitting there. Luis Carlos Lopez, One-Eyed Lopez, the great poet, would sit there and tell stories. Back then, it was a kind of bohemian thing, the people who would sit there and sometimes drink rum, too. Garcia Marquez's father loved to tell stories, and he sat there, too. He lived in a lot of places and failed a lot of times. He had many professions. He was a telegraph operator. In other words, he's the character in Love in the Time of Cholera. The one who comes to town and is the telegraph operator and falls in love with Gabo's mother, who at that moment is the daughter of the man with the best reputation in town. We're talking now about Aracataca, not Cartagena, and one who has distinguished family names, Colonel Marquez. The Marquez Iguaran is a family with a certain tradition in the town. The Iguaran comes from the Guajira region. The Marquez comes from Santa Marta and from Fundacion. And then, she's the prettiest girl in town. And she was very pretty. I met her when she was an old woman, and you could still see how pretty she had been. He was homelier. Even as an old man, you could see he was homelier. He took some long-distance courses in pharmacy, and he was a pharmacist. Then he became a homeopathic practitioner.
Carmelo Martinez.
He died here in Cartagena, buying paychecks. They never pay the teachers. Other people buy their paychecks at a discount, and that's how they live.
Jose Antonio Paternostro.
If the person was going to earn 100, the buyer would say, "Fine, I'll give you 80. Here it is. And you tell the company to pay me 100, and I'll earn the difference." That's the deal. It's called buying paychecks. The buyer of the paycheck anticipates the person's salary. That's how they used to do it, in the park, in the square of the town. Men would need the money, so they'd find someone who tells them, "I'll give it to you, but let's go here." In Cartagena, it was the Plaza de Bolívar, outside the city hall, and the Palace of the Inquisition. Then they'd buy the paycheck, they'd go to the government paymaster's office, and say, "Don't you pay them, he's signed this over to me, and you pay me." It was perfectly legal. I'll give you an example. Marco Fidel Suarez, who was president of Colombia. Marco Fidel Suarez was a poor man, son of a washerwoman, and, they say, of General Obando. Marco Fidel Suarez was elected president, and his mother fell gravely ill. They hadn't paid him his president's salary, and he negotiated the salary for 2 or 3 months with a moneylender who was in Bogotá back then, and who lent him the money. He instructed the paymaster of the presidency of the republic at that time not to pay him, but to pay so-and-so. They threw Suarez out of the presidency because the politicians of the day considered it undignified for the president to sell his paycheck. Carmelo Martinez. Since the world began, that's existed. Of course it has, honey. Ramon Iyanbaca. I'll dare to say that everything about Brussels and Garcia Marquez is based on hearsay because his family wasn't one of those that went to Brussels. He didn't have money or land. In 100 Years of Solitude, one of the Buendias goes to Brussels at the end, right? It was the fashion to go to study in Brussels. But that was information he had heard. It didn't come from his family. My aunts had lived 10 years in Brussels, and before Brussels they were sent to Antwerp. Tranquilina would sometimes spend the night in my aunt's house, one of those ancestral houses where there was food for everyone who came by. Huge tables. Prepared for when a compadre from Aracataca or Guacamaya would arrive because they had a farm or were related to the overseer or something like that. Since the people had to come on the morning train to spend the afternoon doing their work and then could catch the train the next day to go back to Aracataca. They couldn't do everything in the same day. Then they would have to spend the night in Santa Marta. Then that was their connection to my aunt's house. When Garcia Marquez brought out 100 Years of Solitude, my aunt's response was this: "Ay, who would have thought that Tranquilina's grandson would be so intelligent?" That was the response.
2. Raised by grandparents. In which his first 8 years living with his grandparents are explained, and what happens to him when his grandfather, the colonel, dies. Margot Garcia Marquez.
In Aracataca, we lived with my grandfather, my grandmother, Gabito, and our aunt Mama, whose real name was Francisca Mejia, the first cousin of our grandfather Nicolás Ricardo Márquez Mejia. She never married and was a person of strong character. For example, she was the one who kept the keys to the church and the keys to the cemetery. One day they came to ask for the keys to the cemetery because they had to bury a dead person. Aunt Mama went to look for the keys, but she began to do something else and forgot about them. About 2 hours later, she remembered, but the dead person had to wait until she appeared with the blessed keys. Nobody dared to say anything to her there. Aunt Mama was also the one who baked the hosts for the church, which she did in my grandfather's house. I remember that Gabito and I were happy to eat the trimmings from the hosts. Eduardo Marcelis da Conte. Until he was 8 years old, Garcia Marquez lived in Aracataca. Well, let me tell you that the relationship between Garcia Marquez and my family is a long-standing one. Garcia Marquez's grandfather was a good friend of my grandfather, Antonio da Conte. The colonel would go to my grandfather's store in what was called the Four Corners, the important part of Aracataca. They would sit in a little room my grandfather had to the side of his store. He wasn't the one doing the selling in the store. That grandfather was the colonel waiting for his pension that never arrived. He was the colonel who took part in the Thousand Day War. This was at the beginning of the century, and so he had been promoted to colonel. He often visited my grandfather and drank black coffee, and they exchanged ideas there and talked about the things that were happening in the world, in the country. My grandfather had a regular get-together. 3 or 4 thermoses filled with black coffee, some cups and sugar and everything, and people came and visited him and sat in the chairs he had there. So, one of those people was Garcia Marquez's grandfather. Sometimes Garcia Marquez's grandfather brought his grandson to my grandfather's.
Margot Garcia Marquez.
Ah, our grandfather was happy with us. They say he laughed a lot over this story about Gabito, which they told me afterward. When he was very little, he was sitting in the doorway of the house to watch the soldiers march past on their way to the banana plantations. Once he came running in, very excited, and he said to our grandfather, "Papalelo, Papalelo, the Bolgers went by." He meant soldiers, but he still didn't speak very well. "Well, well, my boy, and what did they say to you?" Grandfather asked him. "Hi, a cute little Gabi, a liar since he was born."
Imperia da Conte.
He was adorable, little, good-looking. We were more or less the same age. He was the only boy who lived with the colonel. Our courtyard was very big. Since the house is so big, the part of the yard in the next street was Garcia Marquez's courtyard. We would go to his house very often for guavas. He had an immense yard of fruit trees. His grandmother, old Tranquilina, would give us lots of fruit, guavas and everything.
Margot Garcia Marquez.
Until Gabito was born, Grandfather Nicolas passed for a very serious, very reserved man, and so my mother treated him with a great deal of respect and even with some distance. But as soon as his grandson was born, he melted. He changed. His seriousness went to the devil. He became loving, affectionate. He played with us, sat us on his knee, got down on all fours so we could ride him as if he were a donkey. His friends protested, "How can you do something like that, Nicolas Marquez? Look how you've ended up." Grandfather loved Gabito so much that he decided to celebrate his birthday every month. A party every month to celebrate him. He invited his friends to toast Gabito's birth month. He brought us animals as presents. We had parrots, macaws, troupials. There was even a sloth in the courtyard, which was planted with fruit trees. The sloth lived hanging from the jackfruit tree, which was as tall as a palm, and the animal climbed to the top and began to throw down fruits, which were like custard apples. Grandmother parboiled them, and everybody came by to eat. They tasted like potatoes.
Eduardo Marcelles da Conte. Don't forget that his parents had 12 children.
Margot Garcia Marquez.
Every day, Grandfather took us to visit my mother. This is what we did. In the afternoon, Aunt Mama changed our clothes, our shoes, and made us look good. I remember that Grandmother would say, "Now, Nicolasito, take them so their mother can see them." And our grandfather took Gabito and me, each of us holding one of his hands, for a little turn, as our grandfather said. And when we passed my mother's house, he would stop for a while, caressing Luis Enrique and Aida, picking up Ligia and Gustavo. The family kept growing. Talked about something or other with my father, and then continued the little turn. I remember that Gabito and I always arrived nice and clean, recently combed. We always wore shoes and socks. They never allowed us to go barefooted in case worms crawled in case animals bit us, in case something stuck to us. And we found those crazy siblings, especially Luis Enrique and Aida, as mischievous, disobedient, quarrelsome as they were, out roaming the streets all day.
Imperia da Conte.
The colonel went every night to visit my father. Since he had a shop and all, there was a lot of activity in that house. They'd put out a tray with lots of little cups of black coffee, and all father's friends would go there at night to drink coffee. I don't know what they talked about, because I was very little. García Márquez was there, very small, and so were we.
Eduardo Marcelis da Conte. My grandfather, Antonio da Conte, when he came to Aracataca from Italy, must have been very good-looking. He had 5 wives, just imagine. He even married 2 sisters. That is, first one, then he divorced and married the other one. That's why I'm explaining these things to you, so you can see where they come from. Often even things Gabo forgot about, because this would have been interesting. My grandfather came and married Maria Calle first, and with her he had 5 sons. Then he divorced Maria Calle and married Manuela, who's my grandmother and was younger. The 2 sisters never talked to each other again. If one saw the other coming down the street, she crossed to the other side. But never again, until they died, they never spoke again. With Maria, he had 5 sons, Galileo, Amadeo, Antonio, Pedro, Rafael. And with my grandmother, Manuela, he had 5 daughters. His daughters were Elena, Yolanda, Maria, Imperia. Imperia is my mother. Elena is Nena da Conte, the name of the character in the story The Trail of Your Blood in the Snow. She's my mother's sister. She liked the idea that he used her name, but she also didn't make a big deal about it.
Margot García Márquez.
Well, but I'll go on with the story of the little turn, which continued from my mother's house down to the Turk's Corner, which was the place where the politicians met, and grandfather spent some more time talking there. Gabito didn't leave him. He was always listening to what they were talking about. In the meantime, I began to look in the windows of the Turk's grocery stores. There were 4 corners, and I went from one to the other looking in the windows. Since then, I have the habit of looking in store windows. Even today, it fascinates me to walk and look in store windows.
Eduardo Marcelis da Conte.
Back then, my grandfather, as I was telling you, had a very big, very pretty house on the corner, and it was like the meeting place for people in Aracataca. My grandfather also imported billiards and what they called buchakara, or pool. The wooden house is still there. I hope they never knock it down. In the courtyard, which was where they showed movies, they now have costume parties, bring in an orchestra, and rent it out for carnival dances. One of the columns that Gabo wrote in El Espectador he dedicated to my grandfather. There he talks about how he went to visit my grandfather and went over to the large water jar and tried to see, to take out the water and see where the elves were. The jars are made of clay and are used to keep water cool, and often they have something like a filter over them. They keep them anywhere. They have glasses and the dipper to take out the water and the water jar on a wooden base, the stand. Ah, they came and poured in the water. I remember that back then there was no aqueduct in Aracataca. What we had were water cellars. They were the ones who brought in water on burros. They got it in the ditch. There was no pollution back then. And took the water coming directly from the river. There was no danger at all. By then there was an aqueduct, but for a long time I remember that you bought 2 cans, 3 cans of water. Give me 4 cans of water. The cans were those cans of lard where they attached a wooden cross piece in the middle with nails. The story is that he remembered that when he was little, they had told him that little people lived at the bottom of all the water jars, so he would go and try to get them out. He would go put his glass deep in the jug trying to find the elves. It has a name that escapes me at the moment, but he wrote a very good column about this subject. And I remember that my grandfather's water jar was really immense, and all of the cousins would go running there to get water. A delicious, cool water. A water that tasted of, I don't know what. I've never had that taste of water again. It was mossy. It tasted of moss, of dampness. I don't know. Because there's water that's metallic in a way.
Margot García Márquez.
The little turn ended at bedtime, and we went home to go to bed. Then, yes, my grandmother, who had been busy all day with household matters, put me in the bed, taught me to pray, sang to me, and told me stories until I fell asleep.
Eduardo Marcelis da Conte. There was no electricity in Aracataca. I was very small, and I remember that people used candles and kerosene lamps that have a little thing on top. They're beautiful. People used those lamps a lot. I remember that I walked down the street holding a lamp. In that darkness, people get together, and there's no television. There's always someone who tells the little kids mystery stories, horror stories, scary stories. I remember then that I was panicked when it was time to go to sleep in my bed after the stories that an uncle would tell sometimes, and sometimes my father, my mother, somebody, an older cousin. Or sometimes you'd go to the farms, and the overseer always had his stories, and he'd tell you those stories, those scary stories. All that. A lot of that. That's why I say that Gabo's memory is important, because he remembered many of the things he had been told, things many people don't remember. He has the memory of an elephant.
Imperia da Conte. They sent him to the Ferguson's Montessori. They lived close by.
Eduardo Marcelis da Conte. There was a teacher he had who was terrific. They've done a lot of interviews in that town because Gabo said he had learned a great deal with her. I also believe that Gabito saw his first film thanks to my grandfather. The only one who had a movie theater was my grandfather. He had his own electricity generator, an old thing out back, so you wouldn't hear the noise. Later, they set one up for the whole town.
Imperia da Conte. The colonel was godfather to Maria, my sister, and Maria would say, "Papi, my godfather's house has been sad since he died."
"That's how it will stay," my father would say.
I was very little when he died. The colonel died first. His wife stayed because she had a lot of family.
Eduardo Marcelis da Conte. Gabito lived in Aracataca until he was 8. When his grandfather dies, he goes to Sucre because his father had been transferred there.
Margot Garcia Marquez. I remember the funeral very well because I cried the whole blessed day. Nothing could console me. Gabito wasn't with us because he had gone with my father and Luis Enrique to Sensei on another of the adventures that my father would undertake. Gabito returned to Aracataca several months after the death of Papa Lelo, and perhaps for that reason I don't recall his reaction. It surely had to be deep sadness, because they loved each other very much. They were inseparable. The two of us continued living a little while longer with my grandmother, Aunt Mama, and Aunt Pa, whose name was Elvira Carrillo, and who was the illegitimate daughter of my grandfather Nicolás, that is, my mother's half-sister. Aunt Pa was a very good woman. She took care of my grandmother until she died with total dedication, as if she had been her own daughter. We lived in my grandmother's house until the money began to run out, and she had to live on what my uncle Juanito sent her. Then they decided that Gabito and I would stay in our father's house in Sucre. The family had moved there.
Margarita de la Vega.
For the first time, he lives with his parents, who by now are in a better financial situation. By now, his sister had been born, the one who later became a nun.
Carmelo Martinez.
Sucre was a very important town, but by the 1940s, floods had caused a great deal of damage. It was a town with 7,000 or 8,000 inhabitants. To get to Sucre, you have to go to Magangue. In Magangue, you take a boat with an outboard motor and go to Sucre. It depends. In a boat with 2 outboard motors of 100 or 150 horsepower each, you get there in 45 minutes. Gabito lived in Sucre until he went to Barranquilla. Well, he was studying at the San Jose Academy in Barranquilla with the Jesuits. I met him in Sucre around 1940. We were both 13. Because his house, where his father, Dr. Garcia, lived, was across from mine.
Juancho Jinete. As a boy, he studied here in Barranquilla at the Colegio San Jose.
Margot Garcia Marquez. That's why when they sent Gabito to study for his diploma at the San Jose in Barranquilla, I felt abandoned. I had always been very close to him. He was so loving. We seemed like twins. He finished primary school in Sucre, and when he was 11 or 12, barely 3 months after we went to live in my parents' house, he went to Barranquilla and I was left all alone. The shock was tremendous. The calm and order I was used to disappeared. But what I missed most was my affection for my grandparents. I couldn't get close to my mother because she had no time, bringing up so many kids. And my father, even less so. He always seemed distant to me, so much so that all my brothers and sisters called him tú, except for me. I called him usted. Carmelo Martinez. He always had a writer's calling, because at the Colegio San Jose in Barranquilla, he put out a little paper. I mean, he basically was a writer, a journalist. He didn't talk about novels. That came later.
Margot García Márquez.
He was a great student. He won prizes, medals for excellence, the best at the academy. Back then, the prizes they gave to the best students were little books about the mass because, of course, it was a Jesuit academy. Well, Gabito sent me the book they had given him with a dedication to me. He sent me illustrated cards, medals, rosaries, everything they gave him he would send to me. I also wrote to him in Barranquilla, to the house of Uncle Eliezer Garcia, the brother of our grandmother Archimira, my father's mother, where he was living. Ay, how happy I was when Gabito came home for vacation. Again, the two of us were very close. I tried to get the best for him. I fixed him his little slices of fried plantains that he liked so much.
Quique Scopel.
I met him with Ricardo González Ripoll, my cousin, because they left here to study in Zipaquirá. We went up the Magdalena River in boats back when you had to go to Bogotá by boat and all that. The three of us traveled by boat. I began to study in Bogotá, but I was in love, and love was stronger than my studies. And since then, I've been a drunkard all my life. That was when I began to drink rum. And then, as a punishment, they sent me to study in the United States.
Fernando Restrepo.
Gabo says that the National Academy of Zipaquirá was where he discovered his passion for literature and the novel, stimulated by a teacher who started him reading. I once asked him, "Hey, and how did you ever end up in Zipaquirá?" Then he tells me that his scholarship was for an academy in Bogotá, but there was no more room, and that finally they found him a place in the academy in Zipaquirá, and so he went there. I didn't know the school, except that when he came to spend a weekend at my finca there, we passed by the school, and he looked at it and pointed out where he had been. It's an official academy that had a lot of boarders, only males. That is, it wasn't an important school. It wasn't known outside of local boundaries.
Carmelo Martinez.
He went to Zipaquirá to finish his baccalaureate, and then he went to law school.
Margarita de la Vega.
When they gave him the Nobel, his father gave an interview to the Diario de la Costa and mentioned all the towns where he had lived, saying that Gabo hadn't invented anything. That the story of Remedios, of course, was Senora so-and-so, whose daughter or granddaughter had run away with some guy. She said that, in fact, the sheets had carried her away when she was hanging out the clothes, and she had disappeared. Divine. I kept that interview for a long time. Back then, remember, it was all newspaper.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.